Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Ferris Wheel Classic Rock Show. I've asked the same question every day, I think, for the last 20 years, and I'm sure you have too. Well, maybe not every day, maybe on a bi-monthly basis. And it's this. What the hell is happening with Paul McCartney? You know, you sit in front of the YouTube and you watch the 70-something ex-Beatle warble, Hey Jude, for the 250th, 410th time, and you think, creeping Jesus, should somebody stage an intervention? Hold on. This is not going to be a slapdown, okay, of Paul McCartney. The Beatles are sacrosanct. Speaking against them should be punishable by, I don't know, forcing the guilty to clean Iggy Pop's bathroom. I'm not sure what that means, but I do know that you would never be the same, especially if Iggy is using the bathroom while you're cleaning it. It's a terrifying image. Okay, now I suppose the part of me really has never gotten over McCartney's post-Beatle mullet. For a while during the 70s, I personally knew two men and one young woman who required psychiatric treatment, haunted by the terrifying image of the cutest mop top resembling a stone NASCAR mechanic. And his wife, Linda, she was no help. She had a hairdo that was a cross between a Rod Stewart rooster cock's comb and a Billy Ray Cyrus rat tail cluster. It was horrible. It caused a run on anti-anxiety medication. Look it up. I remember looking at photos from the Wings Over America tour, 1976, and I'm wondering back then, you know, if a rabid fan had somehow managed to inject McCartney with horse tranquilizer. Who let him out of the house like that? Have you seen those pictures? It looks like he's wearing a Bruce Lee silk pajama outfit, topped with a mullet that's so aggressive, Toby Keith called from the future and said he wanted his hair back. Oh, I digress. You know, by asking what the hell happened to Paul McCartney, what we really mean is what happened to him following the breakup of the delightful pop combo known as the Beatles, who officially broke up in 1970. So what we really should do is go over his albums. I think there's 30 albums he's managed to squeeze out since then, and quickly rate them, and that will give us kind of a good roadmap to chart his ascension or dissension in terms of a artistic career, certainly not in terms of his financial well-being. So let's take a look at the first album. It's called, this is strange, it's called McCartney. I don't know where he got that. That's from 1970. Before we get into that, why don't we just say a few things about doing 30 albums in, what, 35 years, whatever it is. He's not lazy, and there's a pattern to McCartney, and I'll get into Paul's patterns later on. He's creative. He loves his job. He loves show business. Okay, he's much better at it than any of his three former bandmates. You know, Ringo tries, but he tends to get either maudlin or grumpy in public. I don't think Harrison or Lennon were really that comfortable, you know, in show business. They're always pulling faces, or George used to go in this kind of catatonic look. With McCartney, I don't know if it makes sense to ask why he feels the need to release new music, almost a psychopathic intensity. That's between him and his dark, twisted conscience. No. But it doesn't make sense to ask if he should be allowed to. I mean, legally. In other words, can we shut him down if necessary? The simple answer is no. No, we can't. Mainly because of financial reasons. He has enough money, it's been determined, to buy 15 American states, plus put a good mortgage down on Rhode Island. He does what he wants. Next, it's fair to ask, I think, is any of his post-Beatle music any good? Simple answer, with a huge proviso, is yes, some of it's good, some of it's great, a lot mediocre, and probably the remainder should be flushed down a sewer pipe feeding into the Charles River. But that's my opinion. How about this? Is it possible to classify his material? What would be fair criteria? Well, how about four generally accepted divisions? How's this? 1, excellent. 2, acceptable. 3, careful, Paul. 4, for the love of sweet Jesus, shut it down. Okay, let's go from there. First album, as I said, was called McCartney, 1970. And the critics just kicked him like he was a three-legged mule. The poor guy didn't really get a chance out of the gate. The hit off the album, because McCartney is always kind of gone for hits. You know, 3.5-minute pop songs, of which he is a reigning god. It was Maybe I'm Amazed, which he continues to do, I think, in concert. Great song. There's also another kind of minor hit off that called That Would Be Something. George Harrison, in particular, went ape on this album. I don't know why it got under George's skin, but, when you look at the Beatles' backstory, which I won't go into now, I can see why. Next up, Ram, 1971. With Ram, McCartney tried to address a lot of the criticism, rather, that, you know, came his way with the first album. It was more professionally produced. And the critics just, you know, let me read something to you from, what is this from? Playboy magazine. McCartney is substituting facility for any kind of real substance. Ow. Robert Christgau writing in the Village Voice. It's a bad record. A classic form-content mismatch. That's kind of interesting. Form-content mismatch. All right. NME said it would be naive to have expected the McCartneys, notice the plural, the McCartneys to produce anything other than a mediocre record. Yeah, boy. So those are the first two out of the gate post-Beatles. My own feeling is, you know, often critics, more often than not, they're wrong. And that can be about politics, finance, you name it, art, and certainly music. And with retrospect, 40 years later, what have you, some of these albums get a re-release, you know, they remix, yada yada. And Ram, especially, has got a bit of a second life. So McCartney had to pull himself out of this situation, and what he did was invent a group. He called it Wings. In my opinion, this is when he wrote his best post-Beatles songs, including silly love songs. I'm joking about the last part, of course. So, you know, for those few human beings in the Western world who have never heard of Paul McCartney's group Wings, well, you're forgiven. It wasn't really a rock group as commonly considered. That would have been unlikely, as the Plastic Ono Band being a real John Lennon band. You know, these are just backup. They're talented, great musicians, but they're just picking up checks. Think about that. How can Paul McCartney ever be just a bass player, singer, composer, you know, standing in the corner? He's a Beatle, all right? I always thought he had strange explanations for starting Wings, but it was probably psychological, you know, because the band he has now is unnamed, and they're great musicians. I think it was psychological, as if, you know, it takes the heat off you a bit. So there's Wildlife was the first Wings album, 71. Red Rose Speedway, 73. Band on the Run, 73. Venus and Mars, 75. Wings at the Speed of Sound, 76. I think that's the live album. London Town, 78, and Back to the Egg, 1979, which I actually bought, God help me. So, I would say, out of that group, in fact, out of his 30 albums, Band on the Run offers the best, and I put this on in quotation marks, the best Paul McCartney music. Could have shown up scattered on Beatle albums. There's some really good stuff there. So let's rate that excellent. Venus and Mars, which came right after, is certainly an acceptable plus. It's a good album, too. It's nicely done. All the rest, culminating probably with, Back to the Egg is a Careful Paul, or close to For the Love of Sweet Jesus, Shut It Down. Paul began the 1980s with the album McCartney 2. Right? Yeah, by this time, of course, he had ditched Wings. And it was kind of like McCartney 1, you know, where he plays all the instruments. And the pain you get is that, you know, this is the guy who wrote, you know, The Long and Winding Road, Fool on the Hill, For No One, Sgt. Pepper, blah, blah, blah. And it's not as though it was Ringo who wrote, what, two or three songs for the Beatles. You know, this is McCartney. So it's almost, let me put it this way. It takes me into a pain point. Paul McCartney has a genius for melody. And I can count on one hand how many times I've linked a rock performer with the word genius. But he couldn't do any wrong, really, could he, from 1960 to 1970. And then he kind of mounted. You think of it as a wobbly bicycle of a career. He finally crashed into a wall in the late 70s, but Phoenix, like, you know, he rose from a stack of Marshall amps as the greatest oldies act in the world. And he pulled it off. He's worth close to $1 billion now, while Ringo survives on food stamps. No, I jest, Ringo. It's all peace and love. All peace and love, and he's just heading off to the Bank of Monte Carlo. He lives, what, in Monaco, I believe, doesn't he? For tax reasons. Okay, we're into 1982. He released Tug of War. He got really good reviews for that. And that was with Stevie Wonder, the duet Ebony and Ivory. I'm sure you've all suffered through that a few times. A lot of McCartney's music is ubiquitous. It just seems to go over the airwaves, and you just can't stop it, you know? Ebony and Ivory. So that was about race relations. McCartney's not good at that stuff. Lennon went too far the other way. But with McCartney, it just gets cutified, you know? And I'll get to his cutesy problem soon enough. So we'll give it an acceptable, because God bless him, he's trying. Next came Pipes of Peace in 1983, featuring two duets with Michael Jackson. It was said he was trying to duplicate the formula using Tug of War, but enough was enough. So why don't we rate that probably a Careful Paul minus minus. 1984 gave us Give My Regards to Broad Street. That album was really a soundtrack album, and it derived from a terrible movie that Paul wrote. It's just brutal. You know, McCartney, when he goes off the rails, he does in spectacular fashion. You know, so that album is a lot of reworking of some of his old Beatle hits. It's totally unnecessary. I'm gonna have to give it For the Love of Sweet Jesus, Shut It Down. You know, Press to Play, 1986. Critics, they were mostly hard on Press to Play, but at least it was ambitious. If you take a listen to it, so let's say it's a Careful Paul. Then in 88, he released an album available only in Russia. Well, at least initially. I mean, you can get it everywhere soon after. But I think it was called Back in the USSR, which is a pretty original title. The reaction to this was basically why. And some saw it as kind of a backhanded compliment to Lennon's rock and roll album, Phil Spector-produced rock and roll album, which is actually a really good album. Anyway, again, not necessary. We'll get to McCartney's strategy of kind of filling an empty shelf while he's working on something else. And this is one of those fillers he uses. Flowers in the Dirt, 1989. Okay, this is from AllMusic. The critic is Steve Thomas Erlewine. He said of this album, quote, Paul McCartney must not only have been conscious of his slipping commercial fortunes, yeah, he must have realized that his records hadn't been treated seriously for years, yeah, so he decided to make a full-fledged comeback effort with Flowers in the Dirt. Chicago Tribune wrote, a welcome, if not wholly fantastic, return from the fabbist of the Fab Four. You know, McCartney managed to pull himself out of a swan dive, something he's good at. He has that kind of survival instinct. And Flowers in the Dirt is a stronger McCartney album, you know, so we're going to have to say it's excellent. That might be a bit kind, but what the heck, it's Paul McCartney. Let's say it excellent. It's excellent. I'm going to skip over McCartney's next offering, Liverpool Oratorio from 1981. You know, I'll mention his classical stuff, but you can't really review it. You know, he either has a lot of guts or incredible hubris in writing an oratorio. The critics generally didn't like it, but who knows, maybe there was something there. I think probably for the first time, his inability to write and read music may have proved a handicap. Classical music is an entirely different beast than silly love songs. So let's not rate this one. It's unfair. Off the Ground, 1993. For the love of sweet Jesus, Paul. That's when that should have been shut down. It's really not listenable. Next up is something that's kind of interesting. He formed this group called the Firemen. It's really a kind of a... He co-founded it with the group Youth. And this is from 94. Strawberries, Oceans, Ships, Forests. It's quite ambitious. Melody Maker magazine said, quote, Paul McCartney has discovered dance music, and the results are staggeringly brilliant, as those that came from John Lydon's similar Road to Damascus-like conversion last year. Truly, we live in an age of miracles. Well, that's not bad. You know, I've listened to Fireman a few times, and it is pretty good. You forget it's Paul McCartney. Oh, why don't we listen to a bit of it? Why don't we get a vibe going? Because chances are you haven't heard it. It didn't get a lot of exposure. So here's Paul McCartney and Youth at the Fireman Project. Interesting, isn't it? That is the guy that wrote Yesterday. He is certainly diverse. Again, writing an album like this is pointless. It's similar to oratorio, the classical stuff. He's left his comfort zone, and most artists of his stature don't do that. You know, it takes guts. Plus, it's interesting. Remember that word. Flaming Pie, 1997, came out. Let's go over to Wikipedia. What do they say about Flaming Pie? It got its best review since 1982, Tug of War. Positively reviewed. It became McCartney's first top 10 album since 1982. It is an interesting album. And take a listen. I'm going to rate it excellent. Certainly, it's better than what we're going to hear in a second. And I'll discuss in a second. Okay, Standing Stone, 1997, another full-out classical work. We can't review that. Rushes from 98, another Fireman album. 1999 gave us Run Devil Run. And it's a mostly, it's an oldies collection. Another one of McCartney's novelty pieces. It's not necessary, but it's fun, right? Working Classical, 1999. Okay, whatever. Liverpool Sound Collage from 2000. This is another Fireman Curio. Can't rate it. Driving Rain, 2001. Oh, for the love of sweet Jesus, shut it down. The album sold poorly, and it's really not very good. And so we get a break from 2001 to 2005. McCartney seems to have backed off a bit in his psychopathic, dedicated work habits. With this four-year break came Twin Freaks, a collaboration with DJ Freelance Hellraiser. His parents didn't name him that. Well, they probably called him that. His real name is Roy Kerr. Potentially electronica. Can't rate it, though, but it's interesting. Okay, Chaos and Creation in the Backyard from 2005. It's mediocre. I'll call it a careful Paul. Another classical album, Behold My Heart. It's his fourth one from 2006. I can't rate that. Memory Almost Full from 2007. This got some exposure and it's a good album. I'm rating it excellent. Electric Arguments from 2008. It's a Fireman album. Can't rate it. Ocean's Kingdom, 2011, his fifth classical album. Kisses on the Bottom, 2012. Paul McCartney essentially sings the Great American Songbook and tosses in a few of his delightful ditties. Kind of a novelty record. So careful, Paul. Careful. But again, he's filling an empty shelf. New, from 2013. It's an interesting album. It's some almost Beatles-esque stuff there, which I'm sure is not unintentional. I'm going to give it an acceptable. And from 2018, notice the five-year gap, Egypt Station is the 17th solo studio album from Paul McCartney. And it's excellent. Good job, Paul. Okay. That is the work. So now we're down to the situation of how do you appraise McCartney? The first kind of a barrier you run against is when you talk about Paul McCartney, you're talking about one quarter of the world's greatest rock band. You can't get around that. You're just going to have to work with that. In fact, Paul couldn't get around that, and he had to work with it. It must be agony. So you end up asking yourself, how can I tell if this guy is putting out good music anymore? I know he can put out great music, but you only have so many songs in you, right? There's no firm answer to this stuff. So you look for circumstantial evidence. For instance, if it wasn't Paul McCartney, could an album like Back to the Egg or like Pipes of Peace ever get made? I doubt it. To be fair, I doubt it. You could hold the same criteria, I think, over any successful artist of that period. Brian Wilson, for example, or, you know, John Fogerty. It doesn't matter. Burt Bacharach. The other problem that arises with McCartney is that you know what he's capable of. You've heard his potential, which is amazing. So you feel kind of let down when he cranks out substandard work, which may not be substandard from other artists, if you know what I mean. And it's a somewhat irrational form of prosecution, but it happens. So if you ask the question, what the hell is going on with him? I think the best answer is that after the Beatles broke up, he found a way to remain happy. Right after they broke up, he was drinking too much, he got into some bad ways. And he developed a self-therapy to get him going again, and involved having a strong family unit and writing and performing music. That's it. There's nothing else happening that's unexpected or alarming. He's an entertainer who loves his job. And maybe he's not going to get another song that approaches Let It Be or Lady Madonna. And he's not going to put an album out that's even 100 miles from Abbey Road. But when he does do even mediocre work, it is interesting. The gift is not taken away. It might diminish. It might be unapplicable because of the times, and we'll talk about that. But it is interesting. It's also important to remember with McCartney, and maybe this is where almost the empathy comes in, but he represents the gold standard, together with the Beatles, of pop music, of what's capable in pop music. and the Beatles themselves could never be as great apart as they were together. That's part of the reason why that group worked, the dynamics. And finally, there's a mystery with McCartney. There's a core mystery. You can ask, has McCartney kept producing music of Beatles era quality? Or can't we just hear that anymore because the times have changed? Stay with me on this, because the parameters always shift. Times change. Appraisals change. Appraising factors change. The answer for me anyway is yes. They're always changing. Nothing's static. But for people like me who remember McCartney in a so-called prime, the older McCartney catalog, as they would say, we can appraise the more recent materials with the parameters of past accomplishments. And in this regard, unfortunately, I have to say his work is uneven. The pattern he seems to establish would be something kind of loosey-goosey like this. For every four albums, you get four excellent songs, so one per album, at best. And from more of a macro point of view, for every four albums, one is acceptable. And there are three of whom you could say, for the love of sweet Jesus, shut it down. And then we get surprises like, you know, Venus and Mars or Back to the Egg. I'm kidding about Back to the Egg, of course. Band on the Run. And always remember, he was one quarter of a band in many ways that changed the world. So I hope I gave a nice little approximation of what the hell is happening with Paul McCartney. And you got a few answers of it you can supply. Write us and let me know what I can add to this, and we'll enhance it and we'll post it. That in closing, I'm going to say I am Ian Clarke. You've been listening to the Ferris Wheel Classic Rock Show, and have yourself a good day, afternoon, or evening.